Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, very good. There we go. Now you're awake. Good to see you on this awesome Lord's Day. You ready to worship the Lord?
Amen.
Has He blessed you this week?
Amen.
Somebody give me one blessing from this side. One blessing, real quick. Time's up. This side over here. One blessing. What? Amen. Very good. Now you get another chance. All right, too late. I hope you have been blessed this week. Yes, ma'am.
I have so many blessings, I couldn't figure out which one to say.
Well, very good. All right. He blesses us immeasurably, doesn't He? Like the old hymn says, count your blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Try that sometimes, especially when you're discouraged. It's not refusing to acknowledge the challenges you're facing. It's just realizing that even in the midst of our challenges, God is still blessing us and ministering to us. And we have many things for which we should be thankful and grateful unto Him. So today, as we prepare to worship Him, remember He is to be the focus. Our eyes are to be upon Him. We're to be worshiping, adoring Him, and praising Him for who He is, what He's done, what He's doing, and what He's promised to do someday. And it will be glorious. The Bible says our words fail us when we try to describe the glory that He's preparing for each one of us who know Him. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank You for this day that You've given us. And we've assembled in this place in order to praise, to worship, and adore You. Lord, we pray that our praise will be pleasing and acceptable to You today. Lord, we also pray that You will speak to us through Your Word, that You renew our minds and help us to think Your thoughts. Father, we thank You for Your love, Your faithfulness, Your mercy and grace that You've lavished upon us. We love You, Lord. Thank You for loving us first. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship Him together.
Good morning.
I
don't know if we're having some technical difficulties or what's going on yet. Well, will we have the slides ready to go? Okay. Are you just working on the live stream? Okay, just record it and I can post it later. All right. Anybody have any testimonies while we're waiting? Any of those blessings you want to mention that you had so many of? Amen. Amen.
That's still good to see him play.
There's nothing like our grandkids.
I just want to say that I want to thank God for doing that back surgery and I think they're doing better.
All right, if you will stand with us, we're going to start out with Indescribable. So join with us. Let's praise, worship, and adore our the indescribable love, the indescribable power, the indescribable majesty of our great God and King.
To the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings. All exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gave source to its light? Of night, none can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All-powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same.
Still greeting everybody. We're going to start out with our next song is going to be Forever. Ready?
Give thanks to the Lord our God and King. His love forever, for he is good, he is above all things, his love endures forever, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love. God is with us forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever, and by the grace of God we will carry on. His love endures forever. God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. All right, Don Peters, will you ask the blessing over the offering, please?
Father, we come to you this morning. We just praise you for all the things you have given us during the past week. Father, we just lift you up, and Father, we don't know how we could bless you as much as we do, but we need to bless you a lot more. Father, we just ask you to reach out and take this offering to reach and build your kingdom throughout these communities. Father, we just ask you to be with Steve. You bless him today as he brings a message. Father, that you just bless each one here, that they maybe someone may know, come to know you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
All that thrills my soul is Jesus. Thank you.
can cheer the heart like Jesus. By his presence all divine, true and tender, pure and precious. Oh, how blessed to call him mine. All that fills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me.
Faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Thank you.
seated, Pastor Steve.
Amen. Invite you to take your Bibles and locate again Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Last week we saw the word destiny. Destiny is defined as your future or your preordained path of your life. Webster's New Collegiate Dictionary defines it as something to which a person or a thing is destined, a predetermined course of events, often held to be resistless. Destined, to decree beforehand, to predetermine, to designate, to assign, or to dictate in advance. Some would say that one's destiny is the plan or purpose for your life, your reason for being here. Jesus Christ knew his destiny. Jesus knew the plan that God the Father had for his life. As we saw last week in Mark chapter 10, verse 45, Jesus said, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Last week we had part one. As we saw what God's plan and purpose is for every child of God, let me review quickly. The first thing we saw was God's purpose for every believer is twofold. One, he wants us to be conformed to the image, to the character, to the nature of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then secondly, he desires for us to praise and to worship and adore the Lord Jesus Christ. We're to glorify him with our words, with our work, with our manner of life. We are to bring him praise and glory. Today we look at part two. Secondly, Paul presents to the church at Rome God's process for fulfilling the purpose in every believer. How does God the Father go about making us into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ? What is that process? What is involved in that? Let's read again from, as you stand in honor of God's word, as we read from Romans chapter 8, verse 29 and 30. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. Let's pray together as we continue to look at that we are being destined for glory. Father, thank you for the word. We pray that you will speak to us through your word today, that your Holy Spirit might teach us something of the process that you are going through to mold and to shape us into the character of the Lord Jesus Christ, the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, may we be open, attentive to what you would say to us. And we pray if there's anyone here today or anyone who'll be watching online later today or this week who does not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, they've not experienced the joy of sins forgiven, expunged from the record, and the gift of eternal life given to them. I pray that today they will be attentive to your Spirit speaking to that inner person, drawing them to turn from their sin and by faith receive Jesus as Lord. I pray that you'll encourage believers. Remind them that you're still working on them. You're not giving up. Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Paul is inspired to write five verbs to describe five different aspects of our salvation. Some have referred to these as the five golden links in God's chain of salvation, or another has called them God's great chain of salvation. So let's look at something the Bible tells us that God is doing in our lives if we know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. A, the first verb, he foreknew. Foreknew is used three different ways in Scripture. One way it's used is to know something before it happens. To know something beforehand, before it happens. Another way is to know something in a very intimate way and lovingly accepting and approving it. And a third way we find this word used in Scripture means to elect, to foreordain, to predestine something. Now, dear friend, we could jump into an argument that has plagued theology and Christendom for years, but I'm not going to. We could jump into an argument between the sovereignty of God and the free will of man. I want you to know where I stand. Yes. I believe in the sovereignty of God, and I believe in the free will of man. Otherwise, you have a number of passages of Scripture that doesn't make any sense. Why should we reason if we have no choice? Why should we choose if the choice is already made? God is sovereign. The Scriptures tell us that in eternity past, God chose us in Christ. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4, it says, "For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight." Those who have deposited their hope and their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ can find great comfort in the fact that God desires his children to be conformed to the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. We can be comforted in the fact that God chose you. A number of years ago, I was driving a bus to Colorado. I had a busload of teenagers and adults, and we were going on a mission tour, a mission trip, to help a young church plant in southwest Colorado. And as I was driving along, I could hear some of the older teenage boys talking just a couple seats behind me. They were talking about which one of them was more loved by their parents. One teenage boy, these were about juniors in high school, said, "No, my mom and dad love me most, more than your moms and dad love you." And then started sharing reasons. And another one said, "No, my mom and dad love me more than your mom and dad love you because," and started sharing some reasons. And finally came around to, it got interesting. I was watching a road. When you're driving out in West Texas and into New Mexico, it just straight for miles. So I was watching the road, but then I could hardly wait for the last one to speak up. His name was Mark. And Mark said, "My mom and dad love me more than all of your mom and dads love you because your mom and dads were stuck with you. My mom and dad chose me." They didn't have to take me. I was adopted. And they chose to love me. And God just blessed me all over again as I disconnected from those young men and began to think of God's love for me. He didn't have to invite any one of us into His family. He's God. But He chose to offer His love to us and to call us into His family. You're chosen. God has chosen to make you the object of His love. Isn't that awesome? Come on, isn't that awesome? He didn't have to, but He's chosen to lavish His love on you. Sometimes the world makes you feel unloved, unneeded, unfit, undesirable. But you remember, Almighty God has chosen you to be His. He didn't have to. He wanted to. When I was in elementary school, we used to, at recess time out in the country school I went to, we played softball. And I was not very good at softball starting out. And I know what it's like when the teacher says, and he calls out the captains, normally the two best softball players in our grade, choose teams. I know what it was like to be the last one chosen. You know, when you're the last one chosen, that doesn't mean you were chosen. It means you were left over and they were stuck with you. I know what it was like to be put out in left field, way left field, where no one ever hit the ball because they knew I wouldn't catch it anyway. And if I did, I couldn't throw it back in. But after one of those games, Neil Husky, who was the best softball player in our school, he was a fast pitcher. His dad was semi-pro, and Neil knew how to throw it. He took me aside and said, "Hey, Steve, can I work with you and teach you how to play softball?" I said, "Wow, sure." And he poured into me for the next number of months. I got to spend the night with him several times, and he would work with me and drill me and show me how to do it. The next time we divided into teams, Neil was one of the still real. He was one of the captains. And the first person he chose was me. He didn't have to. But he said, "I want you to be my catcher." He taught me how to call the pitches, how to catch them, how to block the plate, how to throw out runners trying to advance. And when he called my name, the rest of the class laughed and scoffed. Dear friend, it doesn't make any difference what the world says about you. If you're a child of God, you have been chosen. He set you apart for Himself. Isn't that awesome? But Paul goes on to write another verb to describe that process by which God the Father is molding and shaping our lives into the character of Christ. Did I get any better? Someone comes up and said, tell us the rest of the story. Yes, I eventually became a fast pitch myself through several no-hit ball games and had some great times playing until I got too old to play. B, predestined. It means to appoint beforehand. It means to mark off or to establish the boundaries for something. In regard to the child of God, God has marked the boundaries off for believers. He's established the boundaries of our lives. We are predestined to become like Jesus. We're conformed to His character. A number of years ago, we lived on a farm. Dad was renting the farmhouse while he was pastoring a rural church, and we lived on that farm. And Jess, who had the cattle on the rest of the farm that he rented, he would trust me to feed the cows sometimes. And he wouldn't have to drive out there all the time. So one late summer day, they went and they brought a couple of the steers into the barnyard and penned them up. And he said, now, Steve, if you don't mind, so I don't have to come out every day, would you mind giving these two steers this ration of feed every day, every morning, every night, and make sure they have plenty of hay? I remember those steers, especially one that was a baldy, a white-faced black cow. I called him Blackie. They were special steers. They were getting special treatment. And I was excited, Mike. I thought, wow, I get to spend more time with these steers. And I broke Blackie to ride. I could get on him and ride him around the barnyard while he was eating and everything. I didn't realize why the boundaries had been established. I didn't realize why these two had been pinned up in the barnyard and given special feed. You see, there was a special purpose for their lives. They were to become the fatted calves. And come November, I realized their purpose in life. God has set the boundaries for us. We're not to live like the world. We are predestined to be like Jesus, to be conformed to His likeness. And all through our spiritual journey, we need to be surrendering to God the Holy Spirit as He's ministering in our lives to mold and shape us into His character. Like we saw in verse 28, in all of these things in our lives, God is working for good to those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. God has a purpose for you. And one of those purposes is true for every believer. We are to be like Jesus. We're to be transformed into His character. Let's have a little spiritual checkup. Am I surrendering? Am I consciously allowing God the Holy Spirit to daily mold and shape my life more and more into the character of the Lord Jesus Christ? My wife and I went and saw a movie not long ago. I recommend it highly. The name has one word in it: Forge. I recommend you go see it. Forge. It'll blow your socks off spiritually. It'll grow you in your walk with Christ. It magnifies the Lord Jesus. And this process of molding and shaping our lives. Am I surrendering? Are you surrendering to His work in your life? there may be an attitude, he says, dear child, I don't like that attitude. Are we going to defiantly try to justify it, to accommodate it in our lives? Are we willing to say what he says about it? Okay, Lord. Are we going to run to the world and get someone else to pat us on the back and say, there, I understand, that's right. Everybody does that. It doesn't make any difference what everybody does. You're not everybody. You've been chosen. You've been called out. You've been set aside for the Lord. And there's some boundaries he's established for your life to be like Jesus. Am I surrendering to him and allowing him to have free reign in my life? The third verb that Paul is inspired to use in describing this divine chain of spiritual transformational work that God the Father is doing in our lives is called. That word called, it means to summons to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the equivalent to converted. That time when God the Holy Spirit extends an invitation. He convicts you of your sin and draws you to faith in Jesus Christ. I was visiting with a lady from this community back several weeks ago who's concerned about her walk with the Lord. And I said, tell me, let's review this. Was there ever a time in your life when God the Holy Spirit began speaking to that inner person and drawing you from your unbelief to faith in Jesus? And immediately she began sharing with me that glorious time where she was when God's Spirit began to convict her and the sins that he began to convict her of and that drawing process. And she said, yeah, he called me out of my sin to faith in him. I know where I was when God's Spirit began to convict my young heart, allowed me to see some things that I had done were disobedient, not only against my mom, but it was sin against God. Huey, I left the yard one time when mom told me not to. Our yard was about 20 acres, but she told me not to leave it. But our neighbors, man, they got brand new squirt guns. You know how awesome that is when you're a kid. And there was a gravel road that divided our place from their place, and they said, come over and see our new squirt guns. I said, I can't. Mom told me not to leave the yard. You come over and show me. We're about as far as from here to Teresa. You come over and show me. I can't. We can't. Mom told us not to leave the yard. So we scribbled back and forth, and they finally said, tell you what, you come to the middle of the yard. We'll watch. Your mom will never see. I did. You might think that's just childhood stuff. The Bible says it's sin against God. For the Bible says, children, obey your parents. And if we disobey our parents, it's not just normal, it's rebellion against God. And the wages of sin is death. Don't you make light of what God has condemned. The world does that enough by itself. Amen? I disobeyed. Now, mom's going to be watching later. She already heard this before, but she never knew for years that I left the yard. But Aaron, I did. I knew ahead. I remember where I was when God convicted me of this sin. Dad had just started reading to me that night one of our Bible stories about how Jesus died on the cross as the atoning sacrifice for our sins. He He had read this from the Bible before, but that night it was as though I had heard it for the first time. And when it came and he said the word sin, there was a sting in my heart. Oh, not in my organ that pounds blood in my chest. It, in the center of my being, I had the understanding. God's Spirit shone that spiritual light upon my life to recognize that Jesus didn't just die for the sins of the world. He died for my sin. He had to die because of my disobedience. And he began to draw me to turn from my disobedience and by faith to receive his cleansing forgiveness and gift of eternal life. Jesus taught us in John chapter 5, verse 44, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up in the last day. That night in Ware, Missouri, God the Holy Spirit drew me out of my disobedience to faith in Jesus. In Mark chapter 1, verses 16 to 20, Jesus says, come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And Simon and Andrew, James and John left their nets and their boats and the other fishermen, and they went to follow Jesus. There was a call extended, and they received that invitation, and they acted upon that invitation. In John chapter 15, verse 14, verse 16, Jesus says, you did not choose me, but I chose you. And I've set you apart, I've appointed you, I've ordained you to go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. In Matthew 11, you know this beautiful invitation in verse 28. Jesus says, come unto me. Shaney doesn't say, come into a belief system, although there are beliefs to possess. He doesn't say, come into a church. Although being a part of a local church is very important that teaches the Word of God. But Jesus says, come unto me. A personal, intimate relationship. As I shared with you before, I'm not really that concerned about religion. I am not a part of religion. I am part of a relationship, a personal, intimate relationship with the very Creator of the world. Come unto me, Jesus says. Who? All you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. He saw the multitudes were being weighted down by the religious leaders of the day who cared nothing for the most part of these individuals. They were following their traditions and all their legalism. And they were burning the people down and they were broken and hurting. And Jesus saw this and he was broken, moved by what he saw. And he said, come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, Jesus shares through the Apostle Paul that we who know Jesus are to be involved in this calling process. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal to the world through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. How does God call? He calls directly. He speaks to our heart directly. He speaks through his word. Sometimes as you read the Word of God, you come across a passage and it's though it's the first time you've ever seen it. As God begins to speak to your heart through His Word and you can't put it down. He speaks through others. Others who are walking with the Lord. He also speaks through providence. In Revelation 3:20, we see the risen, glorified Lord standing outside, if you will, His church. They've lost their first love. Oh, they're still busy doing all their churchy things, but they've lost their love for Jesus. And in verse 20 says, I stand at the door and I knock. Oh, what a picture. You've seen the artist's rendering of Jesus in His kingly robe standing outside a door. If you look carefully, there's no latch on the outside of the door. Thorns and thistles have grown up around it. And kind of the dark, shadowy presence shows the spiritual darkness that's invaded. And He stands there with a lamp. He is the light of the world. And He's knocking. And in verse 20 says, if anyone hears My voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with Me. He calls to our hearts. He asks for entrance. But not only for salvation, as we continue to walk with Him, He continues to speak to us. A spiritual checkup. Am I willing to be still and listen? Listen for God's loving voice as He calls me to turn from my sin, as He calls, giving me direction in life, as He calls to offer eternal life to me. Am I willing to hush? To be still. And just listen to God. If you've never done this, are you willing to turn from your sin, your rebellion against God, and by faith receive Him as Lord of your life? The fourth verb, justified. This is a judicial term, meaning to count or to declare someone as righteous. It means to credit to someone's account, to judge or to look upon one as though they are righteous. Years ago, I was living in a state, I won't tell you where, and I was in a situation helping a family, and there was a grown adult son that seemed to be very threatening and that he could risk the safety of someone in that family. And so I had this good relationship with this judge, and I called him, and I said, I need to ask you about something. Do you have any free time this week? He said, sure. And he gave me time. I went by his office, and he said, what is it? And I said, well, there's someone I'm working with, a family, and I think there's some real danger that the son, adult son, may be harmful to the parents. I want to know if you can give me any help. Are my fears justified? And understand the number of years ago, so he got on the phone, a pager, and he called the secretary or whatever she name or title is. She came in with a file. He pulled some things out of that file without letting me see them. But one of the cards, I got a glimpse. And there was black ink marks all across the card. Line after line after line after line. And he said, Pastor, I would say you have well-founded concern. For this person has a long list of violations, but they have been expunged from the record. You see, they literally take an ink blotter and blot out all the record. And it can never be held against that person again. You see, the judge was not telling me that this person was innocent. He was telling me that the sins had been covered, blotted out from the record. And judicially, it was as though this individual had never broken the law. Now the judge knew, oh, he had broken the law time after time after time after time, but it could never be held against him again because it was blotted out. And judicially, it was as though he had never violated the law. He had a new standing before the courts. Remember how Romans chapter 8 began? Verse 1 said, Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Oh, we sang several months ago, I believe it was, It is well. I love that verse. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole. It's nailed to his cross, and I bear them no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. I am justified. Have I sinned against God? Yes, again and again and again, and so have you. But through the grace and the mercy of God, the precious blood of Jesus Christ has been applied to our sin when we receive Him by faith, and our sins are blotted out, expunged from the record, never to be held against us again. And positionally, judicially, we are justified, declared righteous. My sins aren't just blotted out. I'm clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And so are you, if you are in Christ. Amen? Wow. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. When God the Father looks down upon, He sees us as righteous and holy and pure and justified in the righteousness of another that's been imputed to our account. When we become a child of God, the Scripture refers to us as saints. Don't tell me I ain't no saint. If you are in Christ, you are a saint. You have been sanctified, set apart through the work of Jesus Christ and God the Holy Spirit. And you are clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Oh, it's not your own. It's been imputed to you. But God, the Holy Spirit, is working in your life to lead you into righteousness, so that your righteousness is not only an imputed righteousness, but a practical righteousness as you submit and surrender to walk in the leading of God, the Holy Spirit. you're justified. Last one quickly. A final verb we see in this process of God making us into the image, the character, the nature of the Lord Jesus Christ. Glorified. He not only foreknew and he predestined and he justified, or he called and he justified, but he's glorified. The final eternal state of the believer in Jesus Christ, in which God removes not only every sin, but from the very presence of sin. The final eternal state in which the believer in Jesus Christ will be completely changed into a pure, holy, and immortal being that has unlimited access to God the Father and to the Son. This culmination will be complete sanctification. Will be complete sanctification. We are completely set apart unto Him. Ephesians 2, beginning in verse 4. Oh, this is good. Be careful, Baptist. You might go, whoo. But because of His great love for us, God, oh, listen to these descriptive words, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages He might show the incomparable riches of His grace expressed in His kindness to us in Jesus Christ. Wow. He has lavished His love upon us. And as God the Father sees it from His perspective, it's as though it's a finished process. He already sees us glorified in Christ. Remember verse 18 of Romans chapter 8. Paul said, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 17 and 18, Paul says, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. And Philippians chapter 3, verse 21 says, who by the power that enables Him to bring everything under His control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like unto His glorious body. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 2 says, dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when He appears, we shall be like Him. For we shall see Him as He is. Glorification is that act of God transforming the believer's body into the very likeness of the resurrected, glorified body of the Lord Jesus Christ. It doesn't mean we're going to look like, but our bodies are going to be like unto His, glorified. There is coming a day. And what a day, a glorious day that will be. you will be glorified. All of the hold of this world will be loosed. Whether you are caught up to meet Him in the air, or whether your body is resurrected from the tomb, your body is going to be glorified, like unto the Lord Jesus. Years ago, I was talking to a dear saint. She was probably up in her 80s, mid-80s. Loved the Lord Jesus, walked with Him, served Him faithfully. And she said, "Pastor, I don't care about this old body. I don't care about this old house of clay. When God calls me home, I'm casting this aside. I don't care what happens to it. I don't care if it rots in the grave." I said, "Who made your body?" She said, "What?" I said, "Who made your body? Did you?" "No." I said, "Did your parents?" She said, and then she stopped and said, "No, they really didn't. God is..." I said, "Yeah." You see, Jesus said He is going to save us completely. And He's not going to lose or waste anything. He is saving you entirely, body, soul, and spirit. And someday, He's going to resurrect those bodies if you've died before His return, and He's going to glorify them, reunite it with that spirit. And you will be completely saved. I'm sure Brother Winston have taught before that there are several stages to our salvation. We were saved the very moment we received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And as we walk with Him, we are being saved. But someday when He calls us home, we will be saved completely forever. And it will be glory. You, dear friend, if you're a child of God, are destined for glory. Isn't that awesome? So don't give up. If we receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, am I rejoicing in my new standing that I have as a result of Christ's righteousness being imputed to my account? By the grace of God, through faith in Jesus Christ, I am justified, declared righteous in God. As a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, I must not lose hope. God is going to finish the redeeming work that He has already begun in my life. Someday, sin will be completely removed from my life. I'll be glorified, fully transformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. As Paul writes to the church of Rome in this glorious 8th chapter, he reminds us that we are destined for glory. God is going to bring this about in your life and mine. Let's pray. Father, I thank You for this blessed hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Because of Your mercy and grace, because of the love You've lavished upon us, You have saved us. You've cleansed us. You've set us apart. You're transforming us into the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. And someday, there will be complete glory for me. Oh, that will be glory for me. Encourage believers, Lord, with these truths. Lift them up in spirit. Renew them, Lord. For those who have never received Jesus Christ, may your spirit be speaking to that inner person, convincing them of their lawlessness, of the rebellion against you, of their sin. Convince them that Jesus died on the cross for their sins. He willingly took their shame, their sin, to the cross and shed his sinless blood as the sacrifice that atones, that pays for their sin, that satisfies your righteous and holy demands. And when they turn from their sin and by faith receive Jesus as Lord of their life, their sins will be forgiven, cleansed from the record, expunged. They will be clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ and declared justified. Draw them today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As our praise team leads us in this song of decision, will you stand together? If everything is great with you and the Lord, you're walking in obedience and fellowship in Him, will you just pray for others, intercede for others who may not even know the Lord? Some may be watching online or going to be watching later in the week. Pray for them. If there's some who need to repent of sin, they've not been reflecting the character of Christ lately, but as professing Christians, their lives are more like the world than Jesus. Pray for them. If there's any decisions that need to be made publicly, privately, if you want to come and just pray, make these front pews an altar, pray. Pray for others or for yourself. Would you do that as we sing this song together?
Use our spirit in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me He died. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul in glory turned to Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Now I've given Jesus everything. Drew South. the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary, yeah. And your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me.
Thank you. You may be seated. Remember, we have just an item of business to take care of as we close our time of worship and adoration and proclamation. Vince, you want to go down and get those others? Tell them they can come on up from the children's worship. Remember, we've announced two special business meetings. One was Wednesday night. As the budget that we proposed, budget we handed out to you last week for consideration, it was presented officially Wednesday night and discussed. Any questions people had, they were able to ask. And then we shared that this Sunday would be a special business meeting after the service. It's only going to take just a couple minutes as the others are coming in from children's worship. So those adults can participate in that. We will be voting on this proposed budget. Now remember, the discussion was Wednesday night. As announced, for a month or almost, we will have no discussion today. It'll simply be one item before you. If you're a member of this church, guest cannot vote, but if you're a member of this church, it will be yes, I vote to approve this proposed budget, or no, I do not approve this budget. And so what I'm going to do is just have a raise of hands, okay? That way we can see if it's 100%. And we're not taking notes to see if you vote for it or against it. It just, you vote your conscience, okay? How you feel led by God's Spirit to do that. But we need to know, is this approved or not, okay? So all in favor of adopting or approving this proposed ministry budget for the year 2024-2025, would you let it be known by raising your right hand? Okay, those who are opposed, like sign, raise your right hand. Let the record state there is no opposition, so the budget is approved. Now then, it's our delight to be able to undergird this budget as God enables us, right? Through our faithful giving of tithes and offerings through the local storehouse or the church. And we will be giving you a regular report, whether it's every couple of months, you will get to see what's going on, what we've received, how that's being spent, etc. We want to be accountable and transparent, okay? And you can always ask questions if we've not answered one of them in time. You can ask questions, okay? Because we're in this together, and we're all stewards, and we want to be found faithful, right? Amen. Amen. God bless you. Let's pray together and go find something worthy of eating, all right? Father, we thank you so much for this time of Bible study and worship and proclamation today. Lord, you've ministered to me, and I praise you. You're so good. so faithful and worthy of all of our love, our devotion. Bless us as we go from this place into the mission field around us. May we be salt and light, and may others truly be able to see Jesus in us. In His name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a good afternoon.